If men could learn from history, what lessons it might teach us. But passion and party blind our eyes, and the light which experience gives us is a lantern on the stern, which shines only on the waves behind us.
I'd like to thank all the American people who have stood by us during this trying ordeal.
I had received word officially for the first time that the aircraft carrying the 52 American hostages had cleared Iranian airspace on the first.
All the world's a stage, and the men and women merely players.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear
that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
That I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
And will, to the best of my ability.
They are the focus of evil in the modern world.
Preserve, protect, and defend.
Though my pronunciation may give you difficulty, the maxim is, dovayai, no provayai. Trust, but verify.
What should you do when someone offers you drugs?
But George, just one personal request. Go out there and win one for the Gipper.
Failure. Do you remember what Queen Victoria once said? Failure. The possibilities do not exist.
To see that their efforts meant something, you know, and they won't be forgotten.
Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it.
It's mad, but how can you take it out on the people of Lebanon?
We're not going to let a bunch of insidious terrorists, cowards, shape the foreign policy of the United States.
The explosion took place soon after the aircraft had crossed the Scottish border, whilst it was in the cruise at 31,000 feet.
My fellow citizens, I proudly accept your nomination for Vice President of the United States.
We want life! We want life!
Our flag is red, white, and blue. But our nation is rainbow, red, yellow, brown, black.
We are the children. We are the ones who make a brighter day. So let's start giving.
Sing it to the world.
We are the world. Yes, you and me.
It's so huge, and it is so beautiful. It is proof that there is beauty in all things, even tragedy.
AIDS is surreptitiously spreading throughout our population. It's time we knew exactly what we were facing.
Flight controllers here looking very carefully at the situation. Obviously a major malfunction.
I was horrified. I didn't think that would happen. I didn't think that would happen.
There has been an accident at the Chernobyl Atomic Power Station.
3 years ago, a hole was discovered in the ozone over the South Pole, a hole the size of the United States.
Crack is the hardest thing for me to walk away from.
First, it was instant addiction.
History is indeed little more than the register of the crimes, follies, and misfortunes of mankind.
I have sinned against you, my Lord.
Did I do anything immoral?
The matter of Mr. Rose is now closed.
Mr. Rose, you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
I am a material girl.
A revolution is as natural a growth as an oak. It comes out of the past. Its foundations are laid far back.
I never believed that it will really happen, that this wall will broken down.
range distance 7 nautical miles.
Although 56 missions had safely propelled American heroes into space, the explosion of the shuttle Challenger robs us of our innocence and NASA of its reputation.
I was horrified. I didn't think that would happen. I didn't think that would happen.
Are we going to be perfect forever? I guess the answer was proven this morning that the answer to that is no.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Ever since the first NASA programs conquered the once unimaginable, the space agency raced to invent newer and more sophisticated technology. Each step took us a little farther, and the universe became a little smaller. The wonders of space became more accessible. NASA was growing up. The shuttle program, first launched in 1981, showed us a NASA fully mature. The reusable craft became a spaceship for hire, launching satellites for industry, scientific experiments, and secret military projects. Space was becoming big business. In 1986 alone, 15 missions are originally scheduled, and the public takes their success for granted. The Challenger, which took the first black and female Americans into space, embarks on another pioneering voyage. America's attention returns to the shuttle, which will send the first private citizen, schoolteacher Krista McAuliffe from Concord, New Hampshire, beyond Earth's atmosphere. Space travel, once the privilege of a select few, has become an attainable dream for the public.
Well, it was a challenge, and it was something that I always ask my students, you know, to go and seek whatever they feel they can do and reach a little higher.
I think it's made me realize the potentials of space. It always kind of seemed like, you know, we went to the moon, and then it was a while before anything happened, and then all these shuttles started going up, and I was kind of like, well, you know, that's down in Houston, that's in Cape Canaveral, Cape Kennedy, wherever. That's not Concord. And then she got chosen. It made it closer to home.
Any questions on that?
But while schools across the country are preparing to receive Krista McAuliffe's lessons from space, behind the scenes at NASA, engineers and management are in a heated debate. Engineers at Morton Thiokol, the company which manufactures the shuttle's solid rocket booster, are nervous about its safety. Segments of the booster are attached by a joint. This crucial element ensures that the rocket's highly flammable gases do not escape. During takeoff, intense pressure causes a bulge in the joint. Rubber O-rings are designed to expand and seal this gap.
This is shuttle launch control. The weather in the Florida area is going to continue to get much colder.
Today, freezing temperatures are predicted for the Florida launch, and this is where a potential danger exists. Scientists fear that under conditions of extreme cold, the O-rings might harden and allow the dangerous gases to escape. They recommend that the mission be scrubbed.
We presented the information on the basis of what we knew. And what we knew, and I feel very strong about it, is that we had a problem with temperature.
That was an engineering conclusion, which I found this conclusion without basis, and I challenged this logic.
At this point, Thiokol management must make their final decision.
Then we did conclude that it was safe to launch.
We still are at a position that is a bit of a Russian roulette.
You see, the organizations are enormous, and there's different companies involved, and there's communication back and forth, and it involves the question of does everybody communicate with everybody else? If one organization thinks that the thing is qualified for a certain temperature, and the other one doesn't think they have to qualify it for a certain temperature. Now, what do you call it? Bad quality control? Or is it bad communication that one doesn't tell the other what they want or need?
This is shuttle launch control at T-minus 2 hours, 28 minutes and counting. Here comes the 51...
Meanwhile, the excitement of the launch is building. Spectators gather at the launch site. Children and teachers gather in auditoriums across the country.
Yeah, it's going to be hard to watch because I want her to be safe and I want her to have fun.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. We have main engine start. 4, 3, 2, 1, and liftoff. liftoff of the 25th Space Shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
Control program confirmed. Challenger now heading downrange. Engines beginning throttling down now at 94%. Normal throttles for most of the flight, 104%. We'll throttle down to 65% shortly. Engines at 65%, three engines running normally, three good fuel cells, three good APUs. Velocity 2,257 feet per second. Altitude 4.3 nautical miles. Downrange distance 3 nautical miles. Engines throttling up. Three engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go and throttle up.
Challenger, go and throttle up.
Controllers here looking very carefully at the situation. Obviously a major malfunction.
On the day of the disaster, our nation held a vigil by our television sets. In one cruel moment, our exhilaration turned to horror. We waited and watched and tried to make sense of what we had seen.
It's all part of the process of exploration and discovery. It's all part of taking a chance and expanding man's horizons. The future doesn't belong to the faint-hearted. It belongs to the brave. The Challenger crew was pulling us into the future, and we'll continue to follow.
Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind.
18 years after his death, the first federal holiday in honor of slain civil rights leader Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is observed. In Washington, Dr. King's bust is unveiled in the Great Rotunda of the Capitol, alongside statues of the country's founding fathers. He becomes the first African-American to be honored by a federal holiday. In Dr. King's hometown of Atlanta, thousands of people gather outside Ebenezer Baptist Church, where he once preached.
The main thing that brings me out here is that we have to pay tribute to a man who has done so much for a nation that was on its way going backwards.
I'd like to feel that this is the beginning of the move and the dream that he had to see the peoples of the world all at peace.
Most of the country's businesses do not give employees the day off, but many local government offices and school districts close in commemoration.
Day that
we must not just...
Widow Coretta Scott King sets the tone for the observance.
We have to celebrate, yes, but then more importantly, we have to be about doing some things. We have to be involved in action. We have to be involved in negotiation and reconciliation. We have to be involved in trying to bring about a more just and peaceful society and nation.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
There has been an accident at the Chernobyl atomic power station. One of the atomic reactors was damaged.
Human error stretches the limits of technology again when the cooling system in the number 4 power reactor at Chernobyl fails, heating the fuel rods to over 4,000 degrees Fahrenheit and causing a massive meltdown. The buildup of gases in the reactor blows the roof off the building, beginning the rapid spread of huge clouds of deadly radiation into the atmosphere. The most feared condition in the field of nuclear energy has finally happened. Because of faulty design, the Chernobyl blast releases 1.5 million times the cancer-causing radiation than the Three Mile Island leak in 1979. And now the whole European continent is at risk. Still shackled by their secretive ways, Soviet authorities do not report the catastrophe for 2 full days. All the while, radioactive clouds are driven over Eastern Europe and Scandinavia. Then, Swedish technicians alert the world that a major accident has occurred, and the Soviets finally admit the truth, but not the whole truth. Downplaying the seriousness of the risks, Soviet authorities encourage residents of nearby Kiev that there is little danger. Elsewhere throughout Europe, experts see real danger, and children are immediately given iodine solution to try to counter the potentially lethal radiation. Soviets report that only 5 people have died at Chernobyl, but doctors estimate that thousands will die over the next decades.
Nuclear events, including nuclear power plant accidents, have long radioactive memories. And we are going to have to worry about increased rates of cancer for 10, 15, 20, or 30 years to come.
Despite round-the-clock efforts by Soviet workers, the reactor at Chernobyl burns out of control, spewing radiation into the atmosphere for 10 days. Now, the agricultural industry in Europe is threatened as rain delivers the deadly radiation into the ground and water supplies, where it is consumed by livestock whose milk and meat are contaminated. Grains and cereals are banned. Thousands of farmers face collapse.
Of course I'm a victim. I can't sell my farm. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. Even when the ban is lifted, if it's lifted, there'll still be a latent blight left. We'll never recover what we've lost.
In the Soviet Union, a 1,000-square-mile ghost town is created as authorities clear 135,000 people from villages surrounding Chernobyl. The area is so contaminated, it will not be livable for 50 years. The disaster at Chernobyl affects not only Soviets and Europeans, it serves as the prime symbol that all humans inhabit a global village. Given the potential dangers of advanced technology, increasing population, and deadly chemicals, a serious accident one place can take lives or livelihoods half a world away.
Chernobyl has planted a radioactive footprint on the future. The nature of that footprint, how long it lasts, what happens while it's there, are in part a function of the laws of physics and the laws of biology, but they are also in part a function of human decision making.
In the Philippine Islands, 1986 is a year of tumultuous political struggle, ending a 20-year rule. Located in the Pacific Ocean, the Philippines holds strategic importance for the U.S. The president of the Philippines since 1966 is Ferdinand Marcos. Popular with many Filipinos, others believe him to be a corrupt tyrant. In December 1985, Corazon Aquino, widow of slain opposition leader Benigno Aquino, announces her candidacy for president of the Philippines.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen of the press. Am I being heard? It is too high.
Corazon Aquino, affectionately named Cory, who until this time had had no political aspirations, finds strong support for her campaign in the rural provinces of the islands. The one-month campaign is intense. Marcos surrounds himself with pizzazz and hoopla. But there are charges that Marcos has illegally hidden his fortune in real estate in New York City.
We deny the truth of allegations that we have hidden wealth in the United States.
Marcos is accused of vote buying in the provinces by giving out rice and cash. And Marcos is blamed for being lax in fighting the growing communist insurgency, the National People's Army, which threatens any chance for a democratic government. Tensions rise and the campaign turns bloody. One of Aquino's campaign workers is gunned down by a man identified as a government agent. As Election Day draws near, the question on everyone's mind is whether the outcome will be decided by ballots or bullets. A team of U.S. observers arrives to ensure the fairness of the votes.
Very soon, we will have a very beautiful democratic country.
By and large, it will be a fair, honest, and clean election.
But the election process does become corrupt. Voters are threatened.
Will you go back or not?
No way.
Why not?
I don't want to get killed, you know? No way. No way with this kind of election. No way.
Volunteer poll watchers from NAMFREL, an independent observing agency, are forced to abandon their voting centers by armed backers of Marcos.
Do you consider that there has been massive fraud?
They decide to return and face the soldiers in order to reclaim the center. The violence continues. An Aquino organizer is killed moments after voting. The total number of election-related deaths now reaches 90.
We have done everything to make the elections fair, honest, and clean. I am, of course, distressed, but some people don't think so.
After days of vote counting, there is a discrepancy between the official count, which claims Marcos as president, and the count by NAMFREL, claiming Aquino as the winner.
Your resounding vote for me last February 7 compels me to accept the mantle of leadership. Therefore, I shall lead.
Marcos, also claiming to be the winner, is dealt a heavy blow 2 weeks later when his defense minister defects, taking over a hotel and calling for the army to follow him.
A large segment of the Philippine Air Force has defected to us.
I think this regime is about to crumble.
24 hours later, on March 25th, the crumbling begins. Civilians surround the fortified palace in Manila. Inside, Marcos takes his oath of office.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Simultaneously, across town, Corazon Aquino also is inaugurated. Then, on a local TV station, Marcos appears with his family and makes an appeal to the population.
There is no way under which I can step down or resign from the position of president.
Rebels take over the station during the broadcast and pull the plug on Marcos. The station returns to the air shortly afterwards under new command.
Channel 4 is on the air again to serve the people.
Within hours, however, Marcos reappears on his own daughter's television station.
We have no intention of going abroad. We have no intention of resigning. And we will defend the Republic to the last breath of our life.
But a phone call from President Reagan persuades Marcos to abandon his quest for continued power. Marcos retreats to Clark Air Force Base, where a military plane takes him and his family to exile in Hawaii.
We are all very happy to announce that it is confirmed Mr. Marcos has left this country.
Oh, go other place. We don't want him anymore.
It means 20 years of hardship gone. 20 years of being chained.
Crowds mob the palace.
The long agony is over. We are finally free, and we can be truly proud of the unprecedented way we achieved our freedom.
Mrs. Aquino promises that her administration will listen to the needs of the Filipinos and not surround itself with opulent excesses as the Marcoses had. As an example of goodwill, she invites the public to tour the palace, where the luxurious setting shocks the poverty-stricken Filipinos. 3,000 pairs of shoes and hundreds of dresses are among the treasures left behind.
Considering that the salary of our president is not so big, how can they spend for this? So they must be using the people's money.
But Corazon Aquino's administration is faced with demonstrations and attempted coups. As the year goes on, this former homemaker becomes an internationally known leader. But for Corazon Aquino, it is only the beginning of many struggles she faces for years to come. Her government files suit in federal courts in an attempt to recover over $200 million believed to have been stolen by the Marcoses from the government treasury. Ferdinand Marcos dies a few years later, but the court trials continue into the 90s. After an absence of 76 years, the return of Halley's Comet creates an atmosphere of excitement and anticipation. Around the country, people wait in line at observatories to get a better look at the comet through powerful telescopes.
Looked like a small piece of cotton, more or less, little dot.
Is it just that fuzzy thing in the middle?
That's it. Just that fuzzy thing.
The only thing there.
Sorry about that, but that's all there is.
I guess it was a little disappointing. There was so much play given to it.
But the scientific gains from the encounter are as rich as expected.
The darkness of the surface came as a slight surprise that it's darker than we anticipated.
Perhaps in the year 2061, this little boy will get a better view of the comet. Farther out in space, Voyager 2, which over 8 years has now traveled 3 billion miles, approaches the planet Uranus and begins to send the first pictures back to Earth. NASA reports that the craft has discovered an 11th ring and several moons around the planet. Closer to Earth, an unusual airplane, also called Voyager, makes the first non-stop round-the-world flight. Its crew members, Gina Yeager and Dick Rutan, travel over 25,000 miles with 1,200 gallons of fuel. The Voyager makes a flawless touchdown at Edwards Air Force Base. After the 9-day journey, the two crew members come back weary and bruised from the bumpy flight.
How does one feel after spending 9 days in an airplane?
Like a shower. Like a shower.
We'll be right back. Throughout the 80s, state-sponsored terrorism keeps much of the world in a continual state of turmoil. Western nations point the finger of blame at several Mideast leaders, most notably Syria's Hafez al-Assad, the PLO's Yasser Arafat, and Iran's Ayatollah Khomeini. But the one most often accused of worldwide terrorist attacks is Libya's dictator, Colonel Muammar Gaddafi. As Libyan-trained Palestinian terrorists escalate their activities against the West, relations between the U.S. and Gaddafi deteriorate rapidly. Then, when the U.S. gets proof that the massacre of innocent civilians at the Rome and Vienna airports in December 1985 was the work of Libyan-backed Palestinian Abu Nidal, Reagan is furious.
Gaddafi and other Libyan officials have publicly admitted that the Libyan government has abetted and supported the notorious Abu Nidal terrorist group, which was directly responsible for the Rome and Vienna attacks. Gaddafi called them heroic actions. I call them criminal outrages by an outlaw regime.
In January 1986, Reagan imposes economic sanctions on Libya and orders all Americans there to leave the country. Gaddafi is defiant.
As I told you, we support the freedom fighters everywhere, particularly our brothers, Palestinians.
I find he's not only a barbarian, but he's flaky.
Although Reagan is urged by many to retaliate, he says he will attack only if terrorist bases can be pinpointed and civilians spared.
We are expecting this attack every day. It is a case of terrorism, official terrorism, terrorism of a state against us.
Gaddafi aims at becoming the strongman of the Arab world, and his bravado increases. In a recent interview, Gaddafi says, if America thinks it can hit any place, then we can strike anywhere with suicide groups. We would take the fight to American streets.
We know that this mad dog of the Middle East has a goal of a world revolution, Muslim fundamentalist revolution.
Sending a message to Gaddafi that America will use force against him, Reagan deploys the Mediterranean Sixth Fleet for training exercises near Libya. Gaddafi counters by declaring the Gulf of Sidra Libyan waters and dares the U.S. to cross his line of death. The U.S. Navy insists that the normal 12-mile limit applies and tests Gaddafi's resolve in March. During American maneuvers, Libyan forces fire 5 surface-to-air missiles at U.S. planes. They all miss. The Navy then retaliates and easily sinks 2 Libyan gunships. A week later, terrorist activities resume. A TWA plane en route from Rome to Athens suffers an in-air bomb attack. 4 people die after being sucked out through the gaping hole. The U.S. blames Libya. Then, 3 days later, a bomb explodes in a West Berlin disco popular with American servicemen. A U.S. soldier and a Turkish woman are killed, and over 200 are injured. 3 terrorist groups claim responsibility, hoping to confuse authorities.
This act was one of unbelievable cruelty and unbelievable cowardice.
But this time, the U.S. has clear proof that Libyan-backed terrorists did the bombing. Phone intercepts before and after the explosion lead directly to the Libyan capital of Tripoli. Now, Reagan promises action.
Who's responsible for a fine sergeant in our military dead and 50 young Americans lying in a hospital wounded because of that dastardly attack in West Berlin? And if there's identification enough to respond, then I think we respond.
At 2 a.m. Tripoli time on April 15th, the U.S. tries to teach Gaddafi a lesson. Going after military barracks, airports, terrorist training camps, and Gaddafi's headquarters, Air Force F-111s and Navy A-6s streak in low and find their targets. Libyan resistance is too light and too late. Except for the loss of one F-111 and its two pilots, the 20-minute raid is rated a success by the president.
Despite our repeated warnings, Gaddafi continued his reckless policy of intimidation, his relentless pursuit of terror. He counted on America to be passive. He counted wrong.
Although America carries out some military objectives, it mistakenly hits numerous civilian areas as well.
I think we should get this crazy man out of the White House.
Gaddafi survives a bomb attack on his desert compound, but his infant adopted daughter is killed, and two of his young sons are seriously injured. The Libyan leader appears on TV hours after the raid to show his people that he is still alive. But the attack appears to diminish his appetite for direct confrontation with America for the rest of the 80s. Not fireworks, at least not yet. These people are preparing for the upcoming 4th of July Liberty celebrations. In the two-year renovation overhaul, Miss Liberty is newly groomed from torch to toe.
It's a tremendous honor for me to work on the job, and I certainly hope that she'll turn out like everybody thinks it will.
I'm very new in this country, and this was my first job. I'm really excited about it. I'm happy to be part of this.
France gave the statue to the U.S. in 1886 to honor the two republics' democratic ideals. During the decades that followed, the Statue of Liberty became an emblem of America, the first thing many newcomers saw arriving on these shores. From 1892 through 1954, when Ellis Island closed, more than 16 million immigrants were processed on the island in the shadow of Lady Liberty.
Once you got to the harbor and saw the Statue of Liberty, that you don't ever forget.
By July, Miss Liberty's restoration is complete. The Statue of Liberty Ellis Island Foundation raised more than $300 million for the renovation and the four-day celebration. Also in the millions are New York City's crowds. Liberty Weekend commemorates the statue's restoration, the 100th anniversary of its installation, and the 210th anniversary of the United States. Around the country, immigrants recite the Pledge of Allegiance, having just been sworn in as citizens by Chief Justice Warren Burger via an electronic hookup.
For which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
In his first full year in power, Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev continues his quest to change the old order. He proposes a new openness called glasnost and encourages frank dialogue within the Soviet society. Responding to international criticism of human rights abuses at home, Gorbachev frees two prominent dissidents, Anatoly Sharansky and Andrei Sakharov. In foreign affairs, Gorbachev and President Reagan continue sparring over arms control. Then, in September, they surprise the world and announce an impromptu mini-summit in Reykjavik, Iceland. Both superpowers warn the public not to expect any substantive agreements, The Iceland meeting is primarily to plan agendas for a formal summit in Washington in 1987. But Gorbachev surprises the Americans and immediately proposes sweeping arms control initiatives. As aides scramble to scope out the details, the two leaders continue to negotiate over nuclear missile reductions and particularly over SDI, America's space defense system known as Star Wars. Gorbachev pegs his missile reductions to an American abandonment of Star Wars research.
The Soviet Union insisted that we sign an agreement that would deny to me and to future presidents for 10 years the right to develop, test, and deploy a defense against nuclear missiles for the people of the free world. This we could not and will not do.
This has been a failure, and a failure when we were very close to very historic results.
The two-day meeting ends in what is perceived as a major missed opportunity. Each leader blames the other for the Iceland setback, but the atmosphere is now sufficiently friendly that both remain optimistic that real progress on arms can be achieved in the future.
Well, it is my impression that we can deal with President Reagan, we can continue dialogue with him, we can continue searching for solutions.
Love is in the air at the movies in 1986. In Spike Lee's directorial debut, Nola Darling loves being in love, and she has a feast with three men, because she's gotta have it.
And who invited you? I invited all you fools. You were gonna meet sooner or later, so why let it be an accident?
He's got a knife.
That's not a knife. That's a knife.
Paul Hogan brings Australian charm to New York when he courts a reporter in Crocodile Dundee. Kathleen Turner brings her 80s know-how back to the 50s, the era when Peggy Sue got married.
What the hell is going on, Peggy Sue? One week you say if you love me, you won't. The next week you say if you love me, you will. That's a guy's line.
Florence provides the perfect romantic setting for this award-winning screen adaptation of E.M. Forster's novel, A Room with a View. And the women of Alice Walker's novel, The Color Purple, are brought to life by Oprah Winfrey and Whoopi Goldberg, directed by Steven Spielberg.
Girl, child ain't safe in a family man, sir. But I ain't never thought I had to fight in my own house.
Once upon a time, there was a magic kingdom called Wall Street, where people sought their fortunes in stocks and bonds.
Certainly where there's a great deal of money, that attracts people who are less than ethical. And I think that's the issue. Wall Street happens to be in the midst of a big boom.
But there was evil lurking in the kingdom, and its name was greed.
The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works.
Seek wealth. It's all right. Does anyone disagree with that? No. But do it in a virtuous and honest way.
Greed made some Wall Street princes misbehave and bend some of the rules of the realm. It's known as insider trading.
Let's say an investment banker who's working for a company calls up a friend of his and says, one of our clients is going to take over another company. If you buy the stock of that other company, you'll make an extra 10 or 20 bucks a share. And the person he's spoken to goes out and buys the stock.
There's no doubt that there has been a dramatic increase in the number of cases being brought. There is nobody in this world who can tell you whether that means that we're finding out about it more because of the increased effort, or there is more of it. it sure tells you that it is one hell of a problem.
But soon the lawmen began to catch on to insider trading.
Insider trading can hurt a lot of people in the pocketbook. It's breaking and entering into the stock account. It's like sticking your fingers into your back pocket. It's crime.
A type of crime that wasn't hard to understand.
The temptation of Wall Street in a bull market is extremely powerful. You look around and you say, everybody's making money, why shouldn't I? And there's another sort of attitude, and it's not a healthy attitude, and that is that everyone's doing it.
Some lawmen were starting to get angry.
We became increasingly frustrated with the fact that many people seem to think they could still trade on inside information and get away with it.
Maybe we can't catch all of them, but we sure as heck can deliver a message, which is if you do get caught, you are going to lose your liberty. You're going to go to prison.
For most of the 80s, Wall Street was on a joyride. Stock prices soared, making millions of dollars for investors and investment bankers alike. The surge was partly powered by a new form of corporate financing, the junk bond, which was created by Michael Milken, a leader at the investment firm of Drexel Burnham Lambert.
Everything that we like is junk. Junk food, junk clothes, junk records. Everything that seems to stand the test of time is junk.
They're called junk bonds because they don't have the same backing, for example, as the bonds of the United States government, but they're not real junk. They don't belong on a trash heap. And it's a term that's catchy because the securities business likes catchy terms. But it's a way of financing a takeover.
Junk bonds enabled entrepreneurial outsiders to get in on the high-stakes game of buying and selling corporate America. The new breed on Wall Street soon got a catchy name, the corporate raider. Fueled by millions in Milken's bond money, corporate raiders went on the attack, snatching all the companies their junk could buy. The raiders needed help with their acquisitions, so they hired investment bankers and lawyers for huge fees to do the deal-making. And this is where greed took over. Some bankers and advisors couldn't resist the temptation to make millions for themselves by using the inside or private information to buy stock in the target company. Some of Wall Street's white knights became villains overnight. In 1986, the biggest scandal in Wall Street history surfaces. In May, federal prosecutors indict Dennis Levine, a director of Drexel Burnham's Mergers and Acquisitions Department, claiming he had amassed over $12 million through illegal insider trading deals. Levine pleads guilty and feels very bad for what he has done.
I realize that I've committed very serious crimes, which I'm very sorry, and it was a very painful lesson to learn.
And he begins to implicate others who also have been trading illegally. One of these men is Ivan Boesky, one of the richest and most successful of all Wall Street traders. In November, the government announces that Boesky will pay a record fine of $100 million and agree to plead guilty to one criminal felony charge. A deep chill of fear descends over the canyons of Wall Street. In Washington, some moralists condemn the evil that has befallen.
I happen to believe that the White House set a very low standard of public ethics, and that low standard has sort of sent signals throughout the private community that fairly low standards of private ethics are admissible today.
Over the next several years, the scandal continues to unfold as more indictments are handed up. Boesky, Levine, and others trade their pinstripes for prison stripes. Boesky's guilty plea is a major coup for federal authorities, but now they have their sights on even bigger targets, the investment firm of Drexel Burnham and junk bond wizard Michael Milken. Finally, years later, the government charges Drexel with 6 counts of illegal securities trading. After prolonged negotiations, the powerful firm agrees to plead guilty, pay a record $650 million fine, and sever its ties with Milken. Drexel eventually files for bankruptcy, and the symbol of Wall Street success and excess during the 80s is no more. Junk bond king Milken now stands alone. While many on Wall Street revere Milken as a white knight, the man who single-handedly revolutionized U.S. corporate finance, the lawmen are determined to dethrone him. authorities charge Milken with 98 counts of securities violations. After professing his innocence, Milken finally pleads guilty to a number of charges and is banished with a long prison sentence. The lawmen hope this will set an example for other money lords and end the reign of greed in the Wall Street kingdom.
I'm a Yankee Doodle dandy, Yankee Doodle do or die. A real live nephew of my Uncle Sam, born on the 4th of July. I've got a Yankee Doodle sweet.
Do you remember when you first decided you wanted to be an artist?
Yes, and I don't know why.
Can't explain it.
I've never been able to imagine why I got such an idea, because I was very young.
I was trying to find for myself problems to do with form and space and past sculpture and my likings for different parts of nature and so on.
Nicaragua, the war between the Contras and the ruling Sandinistas continues. This band of guerrilla soldiers is trying to overthrow the government of Daniel Ortega. The Contras' cause is an emotional one for President Reagan, who takes a stand against the presence of communism in the Western Hemisphere. He finds himself in a bitter battle over funding for the Nicaraguan Contras, and the intensity of his appeals to Congress and to the American people on the rebels' behalf is unprecedented.
They are the moral equal of our founding fathers and the brave men and women of the French Resistance. We cannot.
The president asks for $100 million for the Contras, most of it in military aid. Congress is wary. With the administration refusing to talk to Ortega and already unable to account for $15 million in past aid, Congress demands a more coherent U.S. policy, which stresses negotiations, not military aid.
I would hope and pray that the policy of this government would be the policy of diplomacy and not gunboat diplomacy.
In March, Congress denies the aid request for fiscal 1986, and the president's hands appear to be tied. Washington can give no money this year because the three-year-old Boland Amendment outlaws any covert aid to the Contras. A network of private citizens is undertaking its own fundraising efforts. Encouraged by the president, they raise money to supply the Contras.
We have received some funds from private sources. Mm-hmm. Now we are improving our supply situation.
But questions arise quickly about the integrity and safety of some of these private networks. In October, an American C-123 cargo plane is shot down over Nicaragua. Two crew members are killed, but one American, Eugene Hasenfus, is captured by the Sandinistas. Hasenfus admits to transporting automatic weapons, ammunition, and boots to the Contras.
He's sentenced to the maximum term of 30 years imprisonment for violation of Article 1.
And goes to a Nicaraguan jail. He is soon pardoned by Daniel Ortega and returns to the United States.
The whole delaying operation, this on-again, off-again battle between the executive branch and the Congress, basically the House of Representatives, has caused a combat situation right here on North American soil to involve all sorts of private Rambo-esque groups. And it was inevitable that that Americans would be killed and one captured. Humanitarian
aid office. Partly because of the Hasenfuss incident, people begin to look deeper into the backdoor channels of Contra aid, and a Pandora's box of activity is opened. Many former drug runners, familiar with the air routes in Central America, have been recruited to deliver arms to the rebels, and some admit to transporting drugs on their way back to the United States.
You'd bring the ship into Colombia, you would load drugs aboard it, and you would bring those drugs back to Panama with you.
I'm not very proud of what happened in Central America. I'm not very proud of my country. I'm not very proud of myself. And I'm sure as hell not very proud of the results.
Logbooks and testimony cite many such missions in 1986. According to some crew members, the Reagan administration chose to look the other way when it could have just said no. Then, on November 3rd, a Beirut magazine breaks the story that soon becomes the biggest scandal in the U.S. since Watergate. Iran, the country that held Americans hostage in 1980, the country that was behind the bombings of the American embassy and the Marine barracks in Beirut in 1983, is now allowed to purchase embargoed U.S. arms through a middleman, Israel. Profits from these sales are used to fund the Contra War, which many claim is illegal and in violation of the Boland Amendment. As details are uncovered, the scandal soon becomes known as Iran-Contra.
This city is awash with rumor, intrigue, treachery. Laws have been broken. At the very center of the White House, there has been the most unbelievable revelations.
Gradually, it became increasingly clear that what we were talking about was a swap of weapons for hostages, and then we got into the whole area of funding being provided for the Contras through a backdoor kind of an arrangement.
As I've stated previously, I believe our policy goals toward Iran were well-founded. However, the information brought to my attention yesterday convinced me that in one aspect, implementation of that policy was seriously flawed.
Reagan's policy goals were threefold: reopening diplomatic channels with Iran, securing the release of American hostages held in Lebanon, and arming the Contras in Nicaragua. The operation is run out of the White House in the offices of the National Security Council, or NSC, a presidential advisory council headed by Admiral John Poindexter. The details of the operation appear to be in the hands of Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North. Almost immediately, Poindexter resigns and North is fired. The president's credibility is severely shaken. Either he's in control of a disastrous policy or he has lost control of his own administration. To brief
you, he's caught between that dilemma of either being accused of having known or being accused of having not known. Whichever it was is bound to lead to some criticism.
The president's stature is diminished. Trying to put the incident behind him, he appoints a commission to investigate, headed by John Tower. But it's the Iran-Contra congressional hearings, televised nationally, that will intrigue Americans well into 1987.